Dear friends, good evening. Welcome everyone to our Gnostic Lab of Practical Application. This week, our subject matter is titled A Need and Greed. We covered this subject on the pre-chamber. And we discovered this week, why is it so important that we understand the connotations of understanding need and understanding greed? Because we have learned about our disproportional psychological dependency on things like money. We have vested our vanity and our prestige and our power into this condensed type of energy. For those of you who missed it on Tuesday, we spoke of money as condensed energy. And to be able to try to explain this a little better, we said, imagine someone who has a tremendous amount of energy, of power available at their disposal. They would be able to move very heavy things, to get many things started, to get many endeavors flowing. And the same thing happens with money. But because our focus has been on our vanity, on our prestige, on our power, by means of perhaps cars or credit cards or certain types of clothing or some demonstration of social status, this may be very familiar to all of you. We have to step back, and we must be able to assign money the value that it truly deserves. Because for as long as we continue with a psychological dependency on money, we are going to continue being enslaved. We will continue being dependent on so many external things that have very little to do with our internal development, with internal transformation. In terms of understanding our needs, we have already stated our needs are very limited to just three things. It is clothing, it is nourishment, and it is shelter. As long as we have a good, safe place to live, that we can remain protected from the elements, protected from the inclement weather, protected from savage wild animals that may exist outdoors. Certainly, that is very favorable. As long as we can use money to take care of our nourishment, and then as we assign intelligent limits to the foodstuff that we consume, intelligent limits to the impressions. Where is it that we use that money to bring and allow impressions that are coming into our mind? We will be doing something that is edifying and certainly edifying to the consciousness. For as long as we apply an intelligent limit, and how do we use this money to provide clothing for ourselves and those loved ones? Well, then we're also doing something that is exceedingly favorable. More so if in terms of clothing, we understand that when we dress, we do not dress for ourselves, but that we dress for others. We dress and we seek to dress in such a way that we show high principles, high ethical standards, that we are not dressing in such a way that we are encouraging, inciting, inviting reactions in others. Reactions like judgments and reactions like criticisms or envies or greeds, etc., etc. We do not want to do that. When we assign this real value of money, what we end up doing is that we come to realize that money is neither good nor bad. I know it has been said many times before that money is the root of all evil. But listen, open yourself to what's new for a second. We will come to truly understand that money is neither good nor bad, and that it all depends on what you make of it. But we have already spoken in terms of applying intelligent limits. Intelligent limits on the money that we spend for the clothes that we're going to get. Intelligent limits to the money that we spend to the food that we're going to get, to the house that we're going to buy. What does that mean? I mean, what is that intelligent limits? Well, then we can understand what intelligent limits are. The moment that we can start comprehending these two things, one of them that is sensation and another one that is satisfaction. Certainly, if we are using of this condensed energy to buy a car, and the whole idea behind buying the car is to indulge ourselves every time that we see it, to stand in the garage contemplating the parked vehicle because it is so beautiful, because of its lines, because of the leather, because of these many fancy things. Well, certainly that is not necessarily an intelligent limit. We are here indulging in oversaturating that visual stimulus. We are here allowing ourselves to be bombarded with an impression that we're not even making an effort to transform. And what happens the day that that car breaks down? What happens the day that somebody crashes? The day that a child, a young kid in your house riding their bicycle, scratches the door with the handlebars of their bicycle? It will invite so many negative emotions, so many negative inferior reactions. So we must comprehend this thing called sensation. In terms of the foodstuff, the same thing applies. We must apply an intelligent limit. And what does that mean in terms of foodstuff? Well, we need to be able to understand what is portion size. We need to be able to understand what is the right concentration of ingredients. Think, for example, of salt and the effect that salt has on your body, leading to create an imbalance in the homeostasis that is that the body looks for at the level of the kidneys. You start accumulating water, it elevates your blood pressure, and it has many detrimental consequences. So if we're seeking to invest into having all of these condiments and flavors and everything exaggerated, we are then overindulging in that taste sensation. And we're exposing ourselves to a tremendous amount of impressions that are going without any type of transformation. So then, if we are going to bring an intelligent limit and we have to comprehend these sensations, how do we do that? And the key to that is in satisfaction. Because satisfaction, it is telling us how much is enough. When is it that things have been satiated? When is it that we have been able to satisfy the need that the body had to be well nourished? How is it that we have satisfied the need for us to have a good home or a good vehicle or good clothing? You see, the typical thinking that we apply, and this is fairly common, perhaps you may see something familiar here, is that in terms of the socio-political, economical situation that we're experiencing in the last few years, many of our friends have said something like this: ah, if everything were happening according to plan, if all things were going the way that my group wanted it to be going, everything would be great. If my life were going according to that grand plan that I had in mind, there would be abundance, there would be peace, everything would be fine. I mean, I guess that we say that in even simpler terms. Oh, if I would ever get that job, or if I would ever have that thing, or if I would ever this or that, things would be better. This is what we tend to think. And I want you to know that for as long as we continue oblivious to how good is our current condition, for as long as we are unable to express gratitude to the way that our life is manifesting itself today, gratitude for the good and the ill fortune, gratitude for the joyful and the challenging moments, gratitude for the smiles and the embraces, and also for those harsh circumstances that we have to live. The moment that we start expressing gratitude for all that, our level of being starts changing. But for as long as we keep thinking that if we had this or that, that things would be better, we would be caught on an ever, never-ending cycle of ambitions. All of these external changes, all of these things that we might be wanting to see happen, etc., they're completely irrelevant. They have no value at all until we are able to understand what is our inner state. What is it that we really have in terms of virtues, values, abilities? What is it that we're still missing to develop, to fabricate? We need to learn what is it that we have and what is it that we are missing in terms of this interaction with the universe, in terms of those interactions with our spouse, with our children, with our family, with our friends, with our neighbors, the people at work, the people in our city. If we don't do this, we're going to continue dependent on everything that is outside of us. And not only we will do that as drawing attentions and drawing affections, etc., from others, but in terms of the things that that perhaps we can acquire, we will continue to make the incorrect mistake of placing more value in money than what money really deserves. Now, some people may say, "Oh, Rick, I think that you're exaggerating this. I mean, I spend money, but I don't give money that much value. That money is not really that important." However, even if you, even if that thought has crossed your mind, I'm going to invite you to reflect on it just a little deeper, and perhaps become conscious of how many times the Amazon driver stops at your front door. Maybe consider the many other things that get into your grocery cart as you go into the supermarket and the value that you're getting back from those. And perhaps you will have an opportunity to discover some very subtle aspects of ambition that maybe you had not seen before. These aspects of ambition that have been seeking to satisfy some psychological dependencies rather than satisfying some of your physical needs. Again, if we do not learn to differentiate between these two, we are continue being victims of exploitation and we will remain slaves. Our practice tonight is just to give ourselves an opportunity to understand where is it that our needs stop and where is it that our greed begins. And for that practice, I'm going to invite you to lay on your back. If you are unable to lay on your back, it is perfectly fine if you choose to remain sitting and sitting comfortably. So if you're sitting, I'll invite you to just sit comfortably with your feet flat on the floor. Allow your spine to be vertical and just rest your hands comfortably on your thighs. If you can rest on your back, the five-pointed star posture is just wonderful. Samael says, "The tenebrous ones always flee before the presence of a flaming star." That's amazing. So let's go ahead and sit comfortably. And as we relax our body, please concentrate on your immediate physical needs. Remember what these are: food, shelter, and clothing. And give yourself an opportunity to reflect on each one of these, rather than you making this an exercise of comparisons, a logical exercise of the mind. Allow yourself to perceive, contemplate, without thinking. Just empower your consciousness to perceive and be exceedingly sincere with yourself. As you are reflecting on these, let your body relax in such a way that you can lull yourself, empowering the mind to become more and more receptive. And that way, as a way of intuition, you will discover where is it that your needs have become satisfied, where is it that your needs end, and where is it that your greed has started. As your practice becomes perfected and your practice is correct, in an internal vision, you will come to see what are your legitimate needs. And you will notice where is it that you're stepping into the space of greed. If you happen to fall asleep, or as you continue this exercise later tonight, if you happen to fall asleep, please keep close your Gnostic journal. That way, you can take note tomorrow morning of everything that you experienced during your astral travel. Very well. Okay. So now that we're here, if you're sitting, sit. And if you're on your back, rest on your back. But let's go ahead and close our eyes and take a deep breath. Let's make sure that we're sitting comfortably. And I will invite you to make yourself aware the sensations in your physical body. If there's anything creating any discomfort, now is a good time to take care of it. The rest of us, let's start with a deep breath in 1, 2. One, two. Now let's go ahead and focus the attention of our consciousness on our physicality so that we can relax the body. Let's bring the attention of the consciousness to the toes, from the toes to the heels, the ankles, the shins, the calves, your knees, the underside of your legs, your glutes, and your hips. Give yourself a moment and experience the gentle sensation that comes with relaxation. Perceive the softness inundating your legs. And from there, bring the attention of your consciousness to the base of your spine. Notice how that relaxation expands into your creative organs. We relax our abdomen, our stomach, see yourself bringing relaxation into your lungs, your heart, your shoulders, and from your shoulders to your elbows, your wrists, your hands, allowing that sensation of relaxation to extend throughout your fingers. Bring that sensation of relaxation to the base of your skull, at that space behind the hair, the head, and in between the ears. And as you allow that sensation of relaxation to continue growing and expanding, relax your lips, your tongue, your jaw. Relax your eyes and your eyelids. Relax the muscles of your forehead. And allow the relaxation to expand alongside of your head until it finds itself at the very crown. And at this moment, we can invoke our innermost by saying, Divine Father, Father of mine, you who are my true being, you who are my internal God, we are here humbly at your presence, asking of you and begging of you for your grace, for your contribution in this practice. Grant us the faculty of objective imagination, the faculty of inspiration, the faculty of intuition, so that we may clearly see what exactly are our needs, so that we may perceive how is it that those needs become satisfied, and most of all, so that we can see how is it that we blindly walk into the space of greed. Allow us to see the thing itself and not be distracted by appearances. Give us the ability to comprehend the significance, the reason of what we perceive. And give us the opportunity to receive the spiritual reality of your teaching. We ask of this in your holy name. So be it. And we together can recite the mantra Klim Krishnaya, Klim Krishnaya Govindaya, Kopihana Vayavaya Swaha. Let's do that again for good practice. Klim Krishnaya Govindaya, Kopihana Vayavaya Swaha. This mantra helps materialize the flaming star around you, keeping at bay any dark or tenebrous entities, helping shield and safeguard you to be even more effective in your spiritual work. And at this moment, we empower the consciousness to perceive and can we open ourselves to that which is new. Show us, Divine Father, our legitimate needs. Show us how we blindly at times walk into the space of greed. Amen. very well. Divine Father, we give you infinite thanks for your contribution into this practice. We ask for the fire of your longing. We ask for strength along the way, so that we may comprehend these defects and invoke of the power of our Divine Mother to see them reduced to a cosmic dust. We give you infinite thanks for your breath. We give you infinite thanks for your grace and your contribution. Amen. All right, so let's go ahead and take a deep breath in one. Let's wiggle our toes and our fingers. Two. And that's it for tonight. So, dear friends, this has been our practice on understanding need and greed. We are always so grateful for your generosity. Thank you, dear friends, for being here with us this evening. And may all beings be happy.